Transmission begins.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tolley Show on the GCN Radio Network.
We're going to do things a little bit different in today's show. There's an important topic we need to talk about. But first, welcome to the show, folks. My name is Josh Tully. This is the Josh Tully Show on the GCN Radio Network. If you want to be part of it today, 1-800-259-5791. 1-800-259-5791. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Google+, all those fun social sites, and of course the website, joshtolley.com, joshtolley.com. While you're there, pick up a copy of the number 2 free enterprise book in the world right now, Evangelpreneur, and grab your copy of that. I'm telling you, you will not be sorry. It'll change your life. All right, so recently, your wonderful politicians in D.C. did something to affect your health. A lot of people don't even know it. Matter of fact, they did a few things. And because what we do in terms of food and health really affects anything else we do, it's important that we address this issue head on. And joining us to do so is our medical expert, our friend, author, chef, surgeon, Dr. Michael Fenster. He's the author of a couple books, Fallacy of the Calorie and Eating Well, Living Better. I have both books. They're wonderful. Doc, welcome to the show. How are you doing, sir?
Doing great, Josh. Thanks for having me on. This is, I think, a really, really important topic and probably one of the most important, if not the most important, kind of radio shows, I think, that we've done to date.
Yeah, I think so. And people can find out more about what we're going to talk about. Then go to your website, What's Cooking with Doc, all one word, whatscookingwithdoc.com. Article Dark Shadows is up there. Doc, just take the floor. Tell us what's going on and what the ramifications are.
Well, you know, as you know, there's sort of been a lot of controversy about GMOs going back and forth, and we've had that discussion, sort of a lot of details that we can get into. But the long and the short of it is that there's been, and I think rightly so, a real clamoring and a growing voice in this country saying, hey, there's a lot of other places around the world that are letting their folks know what's in their food. We want to know what's in our food, too. We're intelligent people. We're Americans. And we want to see if there's genetically modified organisms in our food. And then we'll decide with the power of our purse if we want to purchase those or purchase alternatives. And so really without much fanfare at all, I'm sorry to say, but again, the mainstream media leaving us with no surprises, the U.S. Congress on Thursday, I believe, passed a bill that was introduced less than 6 months ago in bipartisan fashion, which I think in and of itself should raise suspicion, because I don't know when the U.S. Congress has ever done anything in a bipartisan fashion in less than 6 months.
Yeah, exactly. That alone should be a red flag.
They passed 275 to 150, House Resolution 1599. And on the surface, it seems like a great thing. It is also known, in fact, the official title of it is the Safe and Accurate Food Labeling Act, and that's amending the FDA Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, requiring developers of GMOs or genetically modified organisms to submit pre-market biotech notification, and that notification must include the developer's determination that it's safe. And so on the surface, you look at this, and if that's all that you read, that 30-second soundbite, you say, who can be against this? This is what we've been asking for. But as always, the devil is in the details. And what we find out is this is exactly the opposite of what it says. In short, what it allows is developers of GMOs, so companies that make GMOs, to make their own determination whether the food is safe or not, send a letter to the FDA saying, yeah, this is great. You know, there's no problem between this, genetically modified walnut and another walnut. Forget the fact that it actually has arms and legs. You know, don't mind that at all. And that can then be marketed and does not require any kind of labeling. Now, if you've got Farmer Bob, who has a family farm, and he grows walnuts, and he says, well, the only way for me to compete against this walnut that can walk itself, you know, from the cabinet to the table is to say my product is non-GMO and let the folks know what they're buying is not GMO, then they have to go through a certifying process. So this bill actually creates a whole new national governmental standard from the top down, from D.C. down to the states, whereby if you want to claim that something is non-GMO, then you have to go through the certifying process, the expense, the hoops, the record keeping. If they find that you're in violation, you're subject to potentially a $10,000 a day fine for each infraction.
Oh, come on.
Now, let me remind you that when HCA settled the largest Medicare fraud case in the history of this country, they had to sign on to something called a CIA, a corporate integrity agreement. If they broke that corporate integrity agreement for each infraction, their fine was only $2,000 a day. So that gives you an idea of the magnitude in terms of government fines and the stiff penalties that this bill incurs. But wait, hold on, folks. You know, if you thought this was bad, hold on. It gets better. We have more. Because even if you get a non-GMO label, two important criteria. One is that this law stipulates that under no circumstances can you imply that the consumption of non-GMO foods is healthier than GMO foods. You cannot, by law, put that anywhere on the label. Science be damned. It doesn't matter if you have 10,000, you know, studies. The law says you cannot advertise that it is safer or in any way, shape, or form better than non-GMO food. And get this. Foods that contain GMOs in the terms of the enzymes that they use or other parts actually can be labeled and certified non-GMO. So if you're a corporation, if you are a corporation with enough money, then you could take your GMO food and then you can actually have it certified as non-GMO.
Wow.
Yes, you heard that right. I mean, that is, you know, absolutely. That absolutely blew my mind when I came across that. So let me read you the part from the bill. I'm not a lawyer or a politician by any stretch of imagination. So it took me a long time, but I actually went through and read the bill because as soon as I put this post up and told folks I'd be talking about on your program today, you know, I got the Twitter hate mail. You know, you're uneducated. You're an alarmist. You know, look at what the bill says. My response to those folks is, hey, read the bill. You know, I spent the hours reading through the bill, and here's the part it says, and I quote, food label can only claim that a food is non-GMO if the ingredients are subject to certain supply chain process controls, period, good. A food can be labeled as non-GMO even if it is produced with a GMO processing aid or enzyme or derived from animals fed GMO feed or given GMO drugs, period, end quote.
Unreal.
Unreal. And the final sort of nail in the coffin to our food chain, literally speaking, is that if you say, hey, you know what? Well, I'm going to label that my beef is naturally raised, pasture, and grass-fed. Well, now there's a clause that amends the labeling, so the FDA now will control the labeling of naturally fed, et cetera. And then it's open-ended, and it says, and anything else the FDA decides that you can't put on a label to differentiate your product, we can regulate and prohibit you from doing.
Unreal. That's a great place to pause because I have so many questions, but I hear the music. Wow. Just wow. All right, we'll be back with Dr. Michael Fenster right after this. We are talking about one of the most important issues that is in the spectrum of things you should be paying attention to right now, and we're doing so with Dr. Michael Fenster. His website, whatscookingwithdoc.com. Great website. Go there, subscribe. Just make sure you're on his mailing list. Now, Doc, you know, one of the things that I find really interesting about this is when GMO labeling first came up, I kind of travel in a lot of liberty, truth, conservative, libertarian sort of circles. And the response of, well, you know what? That's just free markets. Let the free markets be free markets. And if you don't want to use GMO, put it on your label and then, hey, you'll sell. But one of the things you said in that last segment should basically take a chainsaw to that entire idea. The free market behind this thing was destroyed. And that's the fact that now, as the organic, or not even organic, as the non-GMO person, you have to go through this gauntlet of, I guess, just requirements to make it essentially so people don't do it. And let's just be honest. They're trying to eliminate your ability to market anti-GMO by saying, oh, no, you still have the right to do it. We're just going to make it so hard and the fine so severe that nobody's actually going to be able to do it.
Well, I think that's exactly right. And I think what they did, in my opinion, because I've read, and in fact, other, you know, physicians with big pulpits and, you know, popular magazines, et cetera, have taken that argument, said, you know, this doesn't take away your right to know what's in your food because the folks can just label it non-GMO. But let's examine that argument for a moment, because it's a bit of a non sequitur. What this law does not tell us what's in our food. It, on the surface, is saying we're providing an opportunity for someone to tell you something that's not in your food. And those are two very distinct and different objectives. So for me to tell you all the things that are in my food, including that they're GMO, is very different than me only being able to tell you something that's not in your food. So they're not the same argument. And then to your point, many of the producers of non-GMO, they're smaller companies, they're startup companies, they don't have the funds of the sponsors of this bill, the lobbyists behind this bill, the Grocery Manufacturers Association, you know, the biotech industry, et cetera. And to give you an idea of, you know, the bias with which this kind of was formed, you know, I want to read to you, again, having gone through the bill, something that I found very disturbing, sort of from a philosophical perspective, which was that the reason, from the text of the purpose, where they say purpose and reason for the study, which I've included in the article on the blog site, it says that the reason for the existence of such a bill is because, and I quote, an ever more vocal minority of citizens are creating doubt in the minds of many consumers and policymakers through misinformation regarding the safety and wise use of genetically engineered inputs. This misinformation is influencing policymakers at the local, state, and federal levels and could threaten our farmers' ability to feed an ever-growing population and increase the cost of food for consumers. And so biotechnology activists continue to advocate for these proposals, GMO labeling laws, despite the clear scientific consensus on the issue, period. State labeling initiatives will produce a state-by-state patchwork of laws that lead to misinformation and confusion for the consumers, as well as costly disruptions to the food supply chain, period, end quote. I think there you have it.
What a load of bull excrement. I mean, that is just the stupidity behind that is just appalling if you actually knew what was really going on. The fact of the matter is that right now we can feed everybody on the planet. There's this huge myth that there's not enough food. There is. What the problem is there's too many politicians, drug lords, corrupt, you know, NGOs that are getting in the way. The other aspect of this is there are health risks. And so let's kind of take a minute, because something you said during the break really kind of shook me. I mean, here you are an MD, you're a surgeon, you're a chef, you're an MBA. I mean, you're a pretty smart guy. And you said something during the break that kind of shook me, and that was that if this continues to go through, this might cause you to make some changes in life. Talk about that a little bit and why. Why is this such a threat? Doc, are we just making a mountain out of a molehill here?
Oh, absolutely not. You know, let's you know, take a lesson from history. Anytime the government comes to me and says, the debate is over, the science is clear, you better perk up your ears and look. That's essentially a double dare to go look at the data. And you and I have talked a number of times on the show. There is good data out there, enough data to raise concern. And, you know, many in the scientific community, and not myself, I mean experts who, you know, deal with GMOs, DNA sequencing, et cetera, for example, said when they tried to release a genetically modified organism not too long ago in Key West to try to control a disease of mosquitoes, a disease which, by the way, hasn't been present in Key West for a number of years, but they wanted to release this GMO organism anyway, said, you know, we just don't know enough about this stuff, about this technology, about the potential effects, the proteins produced, to be sticking it, you know, out into the environment where there is always the law of unintended consequences. So, you know, I think that that raises, you know, one big flag. The other thing that I'd like to say is, in addition to, you know, quoting that there's no safety issues, the sponsor of the bill, Pompeo, Representative Pompeo, I believe from Kansas, said, you know, we shouldn't be biased because we're requiring a label, a GMO label, on one product, one plant product, and not requiring a GMO label on its identical, on another product that's identical. And there's, again, the false logic. These plants are different at the level of their DNA. The proteins they produce are distinctly different. That is, those differences at the DNA level, when the tomato has a gene from a flounder in it, that is the essence of something that is not identical. And in fact, in my opinion, provides the rationale for having a GMO label on such foods, simply because by casual inspection, the average consumer cannot tell the difference.
Yeah, and that's a huge point. I mean, to be one of these bureaucrats who say, well, you know, this plant is identical to that plant, maybe aesthetically, but when, like you said, when you're mixing flounder DNA, or for goodness sakes, our corn should be labeled with placards on trucks, because it's a living pesticide, for goodness sakes. Other countries won't even let it in. So to say it's identical is just being intellectually dishonest with people.
It absolutely is, and you bring to home one of the points, which is, you know, a lot of the issue with, for example, the GMO soy, the GMO corn, etc., isn't really with the fact that it's GMO. It's, you know, with the fact that...
Oh, wait a second. Wait, right there. It's with the fact, dot, dot, dot. Don't lose that thought. We'll get the answer on the other side. All right, Dr. Michael Fenster's his name, his website, whatscookingwithdoc.com. Speaking of .com, we left with a little dot, dot, dot. Doc, I hope you didn't lose your train of thought. Can you pick up where you left off, please, sir?
Sure. It was exactly the point that you had made, is that, you know, a lot of the concern that we have, that folks have, for example, with GMOs, it's not the fact even that it's a GMO organism, but it has to do with the accumulation of toxic and toxins like glyphosate, which is the active component of Roundup. And for folks that don't know, for example, a lot of the corn and most of the soy that's grown in this country has part of the gene of those plants spliced into it, genetic sequence from a bacterium that allows the plant to essentially be resistant to this herbicide. What that means, of course, is that you can then, you know, grow this corn in a swimming pool full of Roundup, which kills every other living thing, you know, within, you know, 4 light years of this area. And that makes for very efficient farming. What multiple studies have shown is that these plants, though, accumulate this herbicide, this toxin, and then, of course, when we eat it, we're being exposed to higher levels. And what is the potential toxicity of that? Well, again, some of my less, I think, well-researched colleagues say, well, you know, the World Health Organization has looked at the studies that's been, the vast majority of which have been done by the companies that make these products, and said, you know, there's no problem in the animal studies. Having said that, the World Health Organization this year also classified glyphosate, much to the chagrin of Monsanto and their brethren, as a probable human carcinogen. So, if you do the math, you know, it really makes no sense as to why, you know, we are consuming and now don't want to label foods that contain high levels of stuff that the World Health Organization has labeled as a probable carcinogen. I mean, you might as well have your GMO, you know, corn taco and a shot of, you know, benzene DDT tequila.
Oh, man. You know, what's funny about this is whenever I talk about GMO, and I've talked about it from a political standpoint a few times, how Monsanto has so many people, and same with Archer Daniels Midland, have so many people involved in the government, in the highest of upper echelons there. But I always get this response, well, Josh, that's fine because I grow my own garden. I, you know, harvest out of wilderness and I hunt deer. And I'm thinking, well, that deer genius is eating that same GMO soy and that same GMO corn. So you're just getting it through a different delivery vehicle.
And, you know, and we have to look out for citizens, you know, and myself included. Now, I work very hard to source, you know, my foods. I know where they come from. But the average person, you know, that's sort of our job, right, is to make sure that the average person can go in and know what they're eating. And really, I do feel that contrary to what this bill says on the surface, you know, this is just a clear attempt to prevent us from what's knowing in our food such that, you know, you can't get it back once it's out there. Once this genie is out of the bag, you can't get it back. And it's just not the plants, because the plants that we're growing in this and producing in this manner are what's being used to feed the animal proteins that are in our food chain. And studies have shown that when we look at bovine or cattle, when we look at poultry, when we look at their gut microbiome, what we find is that, yes, you know, the glyphosate affects only a plant pathway, but it also seems to affect the gut microbiome of these animals. And it alters them in such a way that they become changed with higher concentrations of pathogens. In poultry, for example, a study showed that chickens fed GMO-based feed had much higher levels of salmonella and shigella, both of which are human pathogens as well, in those chickens. You know, sick birds don't taste as well. Sick birds are not as healthful to eat. If you were to undercook one of these chickens, you have a much higher risk of developing disease, so on, and so forth. And it also leads me to ask the question of, well, gosh, if they can affect the gut microbiome of poultry, of birds, of other mammals such as cattle, my gosh, what are they doing to our gut microbiome? We have no idea. We're learning that some of our additives can change our gut microbiome, induce inflammation, cause obesity, diabetes, heart disease, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe these products that are associated with GMO foods can do the same thing. We just don't know.
Well, and that's the other thing. You know, it's not like we've been studying the effects of this for 20 years. They basically come up with something at the Monsanto evil lab and say, oh, look, it grows. Let's put it out there and just go with it. And, you know, to kind of dovetail off of that, it's not just plants that they're messing with. I mean, we know that there are GMO pigs. Michigan had a huge fight against that. Michigan said to all the farmers, you have to slaughter all your hogs and go with this new breed. Well, the new breed of hog was more apt to eat GMO crops, where the natural hog was not. We've seen this with fish, too. This is going to come to animals, not just plants.
Yeah, it's already affecting animals, as you point out, with alterations to genetics. And you know, the counter argument that folks use, again, the supporters of this say, well, we've been crossbreeding, you know, plants for thousands of years. We, in essence, have been doing this. Yes, but, you know, that's a pig that breeds with the pig. You know, that's this species of corn that breeds with that species of corn. Again, you know, nowhere in my known universe does, you know, a tomato, you know, breed with a flounder. And you're putting things together. You're juxtaposing, you know, genes and protein productions that are not part of the natural cycle of recombinance. And so you have, without a question, the potential for the law of unintended consequences. And, you know, so that's, you know, again, one reason why, you know, when I'm looking for proteins, I'm sourcing out those heritage breeds that are raised in the right manner, because now I can't just worry about how the animal is raised. You know, it can't just be raised humanely. Now I've got to be concerned with what it eats. I've got to make sure, you know, that it's getting the exercise, the environment. Now we've got to even go back and check the genetics, you know, the breeds. And, you know, that's a lot of work for the average person, and they don't want us to be able to differentiate those differences by picking up, looking at a label, and sort of telling, you know, what's in the book by the cover. And I think that's that to me is not the American way. Let Americans are smart people. Let us decide. Let us use the power of the purse, and we'll let you know.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, that kind of leads into a transition of another evil act, I think, in terms of our food sourcing. And that's what came along with TPP, which is this elimination of country of origin requirements for meat. To me, that is just absolutely crazy. If you go to the store and your meat said made in China, I might not pick up that steak today. But because of the new deals that we have, and of course China's not part of TPP, at least not yet, but because of the new deal we have, it could come out of some, you know, backroom butcher shop in Thailand or something and end up in your local supermarket. You think it came off the fields of Kansas, and no, not so much.
I agree with you, and I don't understand the rationale for, you know, in this age of information, when we're often sort of inundated with too much information, withholding the critical information. And again, it goes to what I talk about, and, you know, folks say, well, okay, you know, Dr. Mike, you're talking about eating healthy. I get this. I need clean, authentic, wholesome foods. How do I get them? And then you start to tell folks about what they have to do, and it becomes overwhelming.
Well, Doc, let's talk about that next. What do we do? Not only from a political standpoint, but from a food standpoint. We'll be back with Dr. Michael Fenster right after this. Michael Fenster, and Doc, before the break, we're talking about, okay, got it. Terrible news, absolutely terrible news, that our Congress basically sold us down the river with this HR bill, 1599. It still has to go through Senate, right? Because this was generated in the House floor?
Yeah, absolutely. So I don't know that there's any plans or timeline that I could see to bring this up, but obviously, you know, as we said in the intro to this bit this morning, the House moved, especially for our Congress, you know, at warp factor 8 speed to get this through committee, voted, and approve it less than 6 months from when it was introduced. So I encourage everyone, you know, find your senators and let them know that they need to vote no on House Resolution 1599. When it comes up to the Senate, because no doubt it will, and no doubt, much like this, it'll probably be very quietly moved along.
Yeah, exactly. And the Senate switchboard, just for listeners, if they don't already know, it's a number we give out often, but if you don't know already, it's 202-224-3121. 202-224-3121. And as angry as this topic might make you, do not yell at the young lady who's answering the phone. She's just doing her job. She doesn't cast a vote. But even if you don't know who your senators are, they'll be able to tell you. And tell them, vote no. And I get it. You're probably thinking, well, Josh, doctor, I mean, come on. these guys in the House, they passed it kind of sneaky, sneaky, fast, fast. Look at all the money that Monsanto and Archer Daniels Midland pumps into these guys. They're probably not going to hear my vote and fight against this. And the truth is, you're right. They probably are not. But at least you did something. At least you made your voice heard. But, Doctor, the real important question is, what do we do as people? I mean, how do we continue to eat when everything we are eating wants to eat us?
Well, you know, I think that's a great question. And I guess, you know, Josh, it's going to open up a whole new, you know, coursework. You know, I just finished teaching with a co-director of mine, Amanda Archibald, dietitian, awesome lady, great knowledge, culinary RX course for professionals. So culinary professionals, health professionals, covering some of these topics, among others. And, you know, I think we're going to just need, you know, food survival 101. How do you shop? How do you procure food that is not going to kill you when you can't sort of tell friend from foe, you know, at the vegetable stand? And, you know, my strategy is, and I will preface this by saying, you know, it does take some time and it takes some effort. You know, but my strategy is it's all in the sourcing. So you got to do your homework. You know, I know the producers locally of the vegetables and fruits that we get, for example. I am in tune with the seasons. I think that's part of a healthful approach to eating. So, you know, I'm kind of taking their harvest as it comes in times, preserving some of these foods that then go out of season through the use of fermentation and other natural types of preserving methods. I source my protein. So again, I know where my beef and chickens and such come from the producers. And it's also important now, as we spoke on the last segment, you got to know the breed too. With the genetic manipulations of the animals, you need to know the breed. You need to know that they're not being fed GMO food. And when it comes to the seafood, you know, again, I've got a fishmonger I've worked with for years and years. He lets me know what stuff is, where it's fresh, where it came in. And to a very critical point that you raised earlier, for example, you know, I generally stay away from, you know, any kind of farmed seafood that does not have a country of origin on it, because those things can be contaminated with all sorts of levels of dangerous bacteria, in some cases heavy metals, you know, so the list goes on and on. And so, unfortunately, that does limit somewhat where you can get things and the quantity and variety of comestibles. You know, another great resource is the internet as well. So, you know, if you can hook up with some, you know, producers there, I have folks that ship me some ancient grains that are organic. They're non-GMO because they're ancient varieties, et cetera. And I hate to say this because I love the American farmer, but in countries where, you know, the GMO labeling is required, if you buy the imported products, for example, pure Italian pasta, you know it's made with 100% durum wheat. It's a semolina grind. You know exactly what you're getting. That's an ancient grain. And, you know, the same can't be said for something labeled pasta that's produced in the United States.
You know, and that's the sick thing. And to be honest, I think a lot of food has been getting a bad rap because of the food or an allergy to the food, but because of the food is no longer the food. And I know that sounds kind of Yogi Berra-ish, but like, for example, everybody has this gluten intolerance now that nobody really had about 60 years ago. And I'm thinking, is it really the gluten intolerance that we're suffering from because people in Italy don't seem to be doing it? Or is it this natural response to the fact that 98% of our wheat and 99% of our soy and all the other stats that are just crazy, they're all genetically modified. Is it possible that we're rejecting the genetic modification, not the real ancient organic plant itself?
I think that's 100% correct. That's a whole chapter in my latest book, The Fallacy of the Calorie. And it was interesting because what you described, I had a conversation with one of our attendees at the Culinary Arts for Professionals course, and we were talking about this, and she mentioned, she goes, well, you know, I was offering other types of starches. We were working with lentils and so on and so forth. And she said, well, that's great because, you know, I am totally 100% gluten intolerant. She said, although when I went to Italy last summer, I just had to try the pasta. And I ate the pasta, you know, the whole time I was there, and it never bothered me. I came back to the States, and I tried it, and it didn't work. So
yeah.
I don't know, maybe it was just because I was having a good time in Italy and I didn't notice. I said, no, you were actually eating, you know, a different kind of wheat. And that was the difference. So, you know, though it's anecdotal, there are studies, for example, that show in kids who have a true celiac sprue, a true gluten enteropathy, which affects roughly maybe 1% of the population, that in some instances, what they can't tolerate are the products of modern wheat. But the older types of grains, in this study that they did, they looked at durum wheat, that the folks could tolerate that without any of the ill effects associated with suffering from celiac sprue.
Well, and, you know, we've seen a similar thing with raw milk. I'm an activist in the raw milk community and support, you know, that sort of effort. And you see the exact same thing. You know, you have all these people with a lactose intolerance until they drink real raw milk, and all of a sudden they're fine. It's like, see, it's not the milk that you are allergic to. It's the manipulation that the milk goes through in its 15 stages of process before it gets to you.
Well, and again, you know, a lot of times when we procure raw milk, we're procuring it from producers who care about their products. So, you know, the cows are not being injected with recombinant bovine somatotropin. They're healthier. There's not, you know, they don't have the issues with the open sores on the udders because they're in a constant state of overproducing the
yeah.
milk. They're allowed to walk. They're grass-fed. We know that just in terms of the milk products, for example, butter, huge difference in organic grass-fed cattle versus, you know, the mass industry produced. So, you know, it can be difficult to sort it out because, as I tell folks, you know, we talk about a strategy. Well, how do I deal with this, you know, this potential epidemic of, you know, food misinformation? You know, it's going to come down to doing that homework and sourcing, you know, what including, you know, what breed, where they are, how they're raised, not just whether they're sort of an organic or GMO or non-GMO label, because, you know, that it seems maybe that option may be taken away from us.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the large point here. That option might be forced away. And it's just like what they're doing now with veterans and Social Security recipients who say, you know, well, we're not taking away your Second Amendment rights, but if you have an executor or a power of attorney to your spouse, then you're going to electively get rid of your own Second Amendment rights. It's the same thing with this GMO thing. Well, we're not taking it away, but, you know, you're going to have to go through like a $200,000 process and a $10,000 a day fine if you really want to do it. But no, we're not taking it away. You can still have your great organic food. Doc, do you have time for another segment?
I absolutely do.
Perfect. Then we'll be back right after this. All right, second hour, Josh Tully Show, GCN Radio Network, 1-800-259-5791, website joshtully.com. That's where you can get your copy of Evangelpreneur. If you order it from the website, I will personally sign it for you. Of course, you can go on Amazon and that sort of stuff and get it as well. It makes no difference to me as long as you are reading it, my friends. All right, we are talking to Dr. Michael Fenster, and, you know, this idea that our government's basically kicking us in the gut with what they're doing to our food labeling. And initially, everybody thought, oh, well, you know, they should label it. Over 90% of the country thinks they should label it. But even those who don't thought, well, even if they don't, the other companies can come along and say, hey, we're non-GMO, but not so much. And you can obviously see it doesn't take a genius to figure out that there's a cabal here, that there's a conspiracy, not theory. And I'm not even kidding. A conspiracy is what? Grab a dictionary. This is a conspiracy. And they have conspired to aid and abet the genetically modified organism industry, and we're the ones that suffer. And a lot of people don't believe it, Doc. And like we were talking about during the break, a lot of people will just say that you're a kook, that, oh, you know, you guys are just overreacting. And in reality, these people have been fed genetically modified truth where they don't get it. GMO truth has taken root and they don't get the real truth. And I think people who are awake and alert to what's going on have been saying that for years. Like, you just want to shake them and say, what don't you understand?
But you know, That is absolutely great and spot on, and I love that. I mean, it really is sort of it's not the truth. It is a modified truth, a GMO truth. And, you know, I think the simple thing, and being a simple kind of person, you know, the purpose of this law, as it's outlined, is to, and I quote, ensure national uniformity regarding labeling of foods derived from genetically engineered plants by preventing a patchwork of conflicting state or local labeling laws, which inherently interferes with interstate and foreign commerce, period, end quote. And, of course, regulation through that vague interstate commerce clause, I'm sure a whole separate topic.
Oh.
But it seems to me, being, again, a simple kind of guy, that if you really wanted to do this in the most straightforward and honest method, you would pass a national law that said, hey, if you got genetically modified stuff in your food, slap a label on it and let us know. That's very straightforward. Not this, oh, you have to go through a non-GMO certifying process to assure that there's non-GMO foods in there. If that's the purpose, to prevent states from making up their own laws and localities from making up their own laws, why not do what 64 other civilized countries, including Russia, you know, not a bastion of individual liberty and eco-green friendly policies, has done. And the counter argument to doing that is that, oh my gosh, you know, it's going to cost so much money and it's going to bankrupt us. You know, poor boohoo, the 300 companies represented by the grocery manufacturers and Monsanto and the biotech, they're all going to go broke. Well, they've done it in 64 other countries, and these companies are making money hand over fist. None of them have gone broke. None of them have not been able to distribute and sell their foods in these countries. And the sky hasn't fallen down on these countries. So I think that really argues against this sort of convoluted, mutant of a law that we've got here. This is sort of a genetically mutated offering in terms of legislation.
Yeah, and do you think it's just anti-free enterprise greed, or is there something more sinister here? And I don't want to, you know, go down too many rabbit trails because it can get dark and weird and twisted.
Stalin said before,
control the food, control the people, and he used his cat as an analogy. You know, how long will your cat obey you? As long as I keep feeding it. So There's a level of truth here where we just blindly think. I mean, Mike, I'm telling you, there are people who think meat doesn't come from a cow. It comes from Kroger's. That milk somehow just appears in the carton. And it's crazy. But when we're this ignorant, there's a lot of truth to control the food, control the people.
There is. And I think, though, the overriding impetus for this law is money. Because what these companies are seeing is a real grassroots movement across this country, you know, started, and I give the credit, to the other hat I wear, to these great young chefs who went out and instead of, you know, going to chain restaurants and so forth, they were locally sourcing, you know, organic, fresh, real food. Why? Because it tastes better. It also turns out it's a hell of a lot better for us. And when you see Walmart having to carry organic foods, they're not doing it because they care about our health. They're doing it because they can make a buck at it. And so these companies are really threatened if people were to vote with the power of their purse and say, you know what, I'm not buying canola oil anymore because, 99.99% of rapeseed is, genetically modified, and it's all sprayed with Roundup, and I don't want any of that. You know, I'm going to buy the small producers, local. These guys, at the heart of their business, you know, forgive the pun, to steal it from you, you're kicking them in the gut. And it's all about the profits, and it's all about protecting the bottom line.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. And, you know, we have this situation where the people are really, really, in a lot of sense, subject to the will of these massive corporations and their government cronies, which is a perfect example of why socialism, even if you think it's a utopian idea, just won't work. But beyond that, what's next? Because like I've been telling listeners forever, everything is a dance step. And the next dance step has to be something else, like, and I'm not kidding about this, lab-created meat, which I've already seen stories on. They're already growing it, and they're thinking, hey, this will save us from all these evil methane gases from cows and goats, so let's just create meat in a lab. I mean, this is something, as weird as it might sound, could happen, and this bill is evidence that we might never even hear about it. It's just going to show up in your grocery store. Oh, did we lose Doc? Anyway, while we try to get Doc back, the point is that that is absolutely true. And they're trying to create these meats, they're trying to create these foods, and of course they hide it under the illusion of, well, we're doing something healthy and something that's a benefit, and, you know, everybody's going to be... Everybody's going to be in a position of a better state of health, but the reality is we're in a constant decline of health. Obesity, Alzheimer's, all these other diseases are coming. We don't have the common sense to link it to all the crazy, weird Frankenstein food we're eating. But Doc, the question I was going to ask, I'm being told we have you back, is the next dance step to this is even freakier, where they're really creating lab-created meat with the intention of selling it in stores, and with the bills that are passed, the TPP, all this sort of stuff, they could put lab-created meat in your grocery store and not even tell you about it.
No, that's absolutely right. And, you know, I thought it was kind of odd that I got cut off right in, disconnected right in the middle when we were talking about how the motivating profit for the motivation for this is, I believe, is dollars. It's the bottom line. You know, these guys, any way they can, the idea is to create an offering and maximize their profit. And if I eliminate your ability to differentiate between the quality of the products, then your driver is price. I mean, that's what's going to determine food value for you. And these companies, you know, are able to offer a substandard product at much less than real authentic food. And when we lose the ability to choose to differentiate our food, we lose the ability to control our health. And, you know, when people say, well, you know, at least you got your health, you know, that may be taken out of our hands. I mean, I believe that this is, you know, perhaps one of the greatest potential insults to human health.
And disasters to humanity. Hold on one second, Doc. We're up against the break. Stay where you're at. We'll be back right after this. Talking to Dr. Michael Fenster about this lunacy that is happening right now. See, this is why it's important. What's interesting about this is so far the responses have been, Josh, I absolutely love this show. You have to tell everybody about this show. And then other people are saying, well, why do I even really care? And that's the point. The point is that, do you eat? Here's the litmus test. If you eat, you should care. So all of you people who don't eat, nah, you can just turn the channel. If you do eat, though, then you need to pay attention. And the fact that we're not paying attention is what allowed these people to get away with it in the first place. And, Doc, during the break, we were talking about how, you know, they're so mischievous, these people who just try to abuse capitalism and destroy free enterprise for their own profit. And one of the elements that they use is labeling, speaking of non-GMO labeling, but they label things in such a way that even the ingredients label, which, you know, a mom or a dad goes to the store, they read the label, think, oh, well, this is a healthy thing because there's nothing bad in the first three items they list. Tell us a little bit about how that is so misleading and in a lot of cases not even close to true.
Well, you know, and you're spot on. I mean, there's an excellent book. It was a little heavy reading because it was very dense in the science and the studies, but it was written by a former FDA commissioner, David Kessler, The End of Eating in America. And, you know, he goes into the details of how much money, time, energy is spent by agribusiness and the modern food industry into making you addicted to their products and sort of hiding the facts from you so you don't become concerned about them. And the labeling and the advertising is a key method. And an example, you can pick something up and you see it says it has rice, wheat, barley, you know, and down around the fifth, sixth item, it'll say high fructose corn syrup, and then a little further down, dextrose, and they'll say, you know, maltodextrose syrup. And you look at it and you say, well, it's got a little bit of high fructose corn syrup, maybe a little bit of sugar, but, you know, that's way down the ingredient list. It's not too bad. I'm getting all these healthy whole grains. What you don't realize is those are all different names for the same thing. It's all sugar. And if you just listed sugar, what you'd see would be like the number one ingredient, and that this isn't a healthy and smart choice. You know, and now with this potential GMO labeling, you know, you're not even going to know if your rice is GMO, if your wheat is loaded with glyphosate. You know, we're losing the ability to determine what we eat. Something that helped us survive as a species and get to where we are, I think that this could potentially be a turning point if it were to occur worldwide, if other places follow the U.S.'s lead, or we poison the rest of the world by exporting our food products and they had to buy them. Josh, this is as important as the agricultural revolution. The agricultural revolution was a turning point because for the first time ever, we were in control of our food. We weren't dependent on what we could happen to find, what we could happen to hunt. We were in control of our food. That's what set us on the path to the human civilization and all our achievements. We're about to give that away.
Well, and you know, they love to hide things. They love to legislate through diversion. And I fear that that's exactly what's happening here. Like, for example, the U.S. no longer has any lead smelting facilities, none whatsoever. So all the lead ammunition now has to come from someplace else. So the U.S. government can say, hey, you know what? We're not taking away Second Amendment rights. We're not adhering to UN treaties because, you know, they're not ratified by Congress. However, the UN treaty says that no other nation can sell lead to countries that aren't part of the UN treaty. So, you know, if you can't get bullets anymore, that's just part of the consequence of not wanting us to push forward through the UN treaty. But no, we can't make them here. And they do these sort of things, and they do them all the time. And when you have something as large as the food industry, for goodness sakes, the first targets we took out in Iraq because of these weapons of mass destruction, right? The first targets we took out were not military installations. They were the seed stores, the seed vaults. Well, why? Well, the first company in was not Shell, contrary to, you know, liberal media belief. The first company in was Monsanto. Shocker. So when we have things like TPP that say, well, you know, 46 countries ban GMO, oh, however, there's little asterisks in TPP that say, yeah, you know, even if you're in those countries, you're not going to be safe from American food exports anymore. I mean, this is really, like you said, something that could have a global impact, even on countries that think they're safe because they don't do GMO themselves.
That's absolutely right. I mean, the potential, you know, detriment, if we look at this in terms of, you know, the impacts on our food and food pathways, you know, I highlighted the first one, which was positive, the agricultural revolution. You know, then we look at the industrial revolution, which really set us down this road in terms of, you know, changing the composition of food and food pathways. And what we sit at now with this GMOs, if it goes forward and if it is sort of unleashed upon the world, we have no idea what these consequences consequences are. And once this genie is sort of out of the bottle, I don't think you're going to be able to put it back in. I don't think saying, oh, you know, this was a really bad mistake. You know, if you look at our track record, right, you know, We Find White Bread came out in the 1880s, I believe. And there was Yates noticed that people ate all this delicious new white bread were suffering from some diseases, it seemed. So she formed the Bread Reform League. For decades, she was poo-pooed because the science said, oh, you're crazy, lady, there's nothing there. Well, the person who found out what that little missing item was in refined white bread called vitamins, you know, won the Nobel Prize. So she was right all along, and oops, yeah, I guess you were right, we'll fortify the white bread now. Anybody familiar with something called trans fatty acids? They've been around since the late 1800s as well. It wasn't until the 1990s that reports and data came in that, hey, these could be causing massive amounts of inflammation, heart disease, strokes, etc. When we got that information in the 90s, it wasn't until the mid-2000s that the FDA said, yeah, we better limit this stuff. Looks a little toxic. Only this year have they decided to phase it out because of such detrimental health effects. So don't tell me that we've got a great governmental track record when we say the debate is settled, it's safe.
Are there other doctors like you who are realizing that this is a problem? Well, that is true. That's absolutely true. But are there other doctors who are trying to be like you then?
When I disappear after today's performance.
We're going to have to put you in witness protection, I think, after today. But honestly, are there other doctors who are at least trying to be like you? Are they saying, hey, you know what? We are health professionals, and this whole idea that we can genetically modify things and not expect a consequence, are they speaking up?
There are, and you know, we just finished a course called Culinary RX for Professionals, and included culinary professionals who are now getting involved in this movement. They're concerned about it, and a number of health professionals, dietitians, nutritionists, nurses, physicians, naturopaths, DOs, MDs. Great first course. I encourage folks to go to fieldtoplate.com, look at Culinary RX. You can see what we taught. We may be offering more courses. But, yeah, the docs are really starting to get involved with this now.
Hey, Doc, hold on. Wait, we're up against a break. We'll continue. So much to cover. We'll be back right after this. All right, we're talking to Dr. Michael Fenster, and there is a question about entrepreneurship that I'm supposed to answer. I told a wonderful listener that I'd answer it today. I might have to push it off to tomorrow, depending on how this goes. But, Doc, we heard from a couple people. I want to share some things with you. The first one is Sherry in Missouri that says there have been quite a few naturopathics and others lately who have, quote-unquote, you know, died in the last month. Very mysterious. I don't know if you've actually been following that, Mike, but it has been nuts.
Yeah, I haven't, and that's why it was only half in jest that I said, you know, you promised to put this on 24-hour loop if these are my final words.
No, well, you know what? As weird as this sounds, I'm going to ask you an honest question. And I know we've known each other for years now. We've been friends, but I'm going to ask you an honest question so we really get it on tape. Dr. Michael Fenster, do you have any intention of killing yourself?
No. Not at all.
and as weird as that might sound, it's a serious thing. I actually got that from another show that airs after me who had somebody who was revealing some truth, and he asked her that question on purpose, and I think it was 2 or 3 days later she was found hung in a barn. And statistically, women don't hang themselves as a form of suicide. That's typically a male thing. And you know, it's crazy because there are people who are dying because of this. But anyway, Sherry from Missouri is praying for you. Now, what about these companies?
Thanks, Sherry, and I hope to be here to annoy people for many, many years.
I hope so, too. What about these companies, these stores that are making this push to push forth organics? You know, I was just sent some stuff about some stores in Missouri as well, some grocery stores that are pushing through the green stuff, the organic stuff. This bill's going to affect them, because isn't it true that even though we see this kind of what that one politician called that vocal minority, we're seeing a rise and a growth of that vocal minority this bill is going to be basically their response to wonderful companies like this, isn't it?
It is, and I want to point out that that actually wasn't one policy. That thing I read with the vocal minority, that is in the reason and purpose for the bill. So everyone that voted for, all 275 members of Congress, signed on that we, including myself in this category, this vocal minority who don't have any science, we're just a bunch of troublemakers. That's one thing I think that was incredibly disturbing. That wasn't sort of a speech. That is written, and again, if folks go to the blog, I've included the purpose and needs section from the bill where that actual quote is in there. Believe it or not, that is your government telling you, hey, vocal minority, you're causing trouble. We're going to silence you. Now, to your question about the grocery stores, absolutely is a problem. And what we hope is that, you know, the smaller independent grocery stores, there may be a market for people that will do the homework for us and can say, hey, you know, I've sourced this for you. It comes from this farm. I know how these farmers raise it. You know, it can't be on the label, but I can tell you there's no GMO used here. Yes, it costs a little bit more, but I can assure you of the quality of the food that you're getting, because when we can't determine the quality of the food we eat anymore, what drives our perception of food value becomes the price, and that's where we lose out to the big agribusiness.
Well, and you know, and that's really a call out to the listeners. If you have these companies that will deliver organic food or these co-ops that you're part of, it's really time that you step up and really purchase from them, really support them, because this bill is an effort to, in the next 48 months, put those people that you think are doing this wonderful work out of business. And case in point, Mike, and this is what I was going to ask you, I remembered now. We're seeing a lot of pushback against farm-to-table sort of efforts. I know in Nevada there was a farmer/restaurateur who created this wonderful menu, picked it, grew it right there on premises, cut it up, cooked it, served it to them. The government shows up, pours bleach over all the food, and was upset and said, well, you know, this wasn't inspected by a USDA facility. I know there are a number of states that if you are a hunter, you cannot give meat to your neighbor. And the excuse that they're using is because, you know, you did not process your meat in a USDA facility. You could have processed it in your garage, so you can't do that. There are 17 states where collecting rainwater is not illegal. So they're trying really hard to manipulate this system so we can't feed ourselves.
And you want to know a funny corollary to that most people don't know, is that all this foreign seafood that we get from third world countries that's imported, etc., it's not subject to any inspection. All seafood's inspection is completely voluntary. So while they won't let the guy who's growing organically, serving it in his restaurant, you know, basically the way mankind has gotten food for tens of thousands of years, you know, you can have some, you know, highly toxic, you know, shrimp grown in a mud puddle, you know, over in Asia somewhere, and you know that may be what you're buying in your supermarket counter. It's totally insane.
It is insane, especially when we see things like Fukushima happening, and you know, again, instead of being honest with us that of the danger level, they just changed the level which is considered dangerous. It's just it's crazy.
Well, that's the exact logic that's used in this bill, right? It's like, well, you know, people want to know what's in their food. They want to know if there's a GMO in their food. Let's flip that and say we're not going to label anything that's GMO, but if you want to say that there's no GMO in your food, then the onus is on you. So you know what? You're guilty before, you know, you're not presumed innocent, proven guilty. You're just assumed guilty.
Well, you know, and one thing that you said in the first segment of this show that I think we need to come back to real quick is the fact that they've created loopholes for themselves where even if it is GMO, because of the weird loophole, they can call it organic because, you know, it only uses certain elements or something. That alone is scary.
That is, you know, it's, you know, Josh, it's one of those things when I read that, I kind of shake my head and you go back and you read it. Yeah. And then I, you know, went to other sources that, you know, have a more legalistic background to make sure I read that right. Because, and I'll read the quote again because I think it's so damning. It says, and I quote, A food can be labeled as non-GMO even if it is produced with a GMO processing aid or enzyme or derived from animals fed GMO feed or given GMO drugs, period, end quote.
Oh, my goodness. See, that's... And you see all these stories. Here's the disheartening thing. You see all these stories about, you know, chickens that are so genetically messed up that they break their own bones under their own weight. They're like five times larger than a natural chicken should be. You see these movies like Food Inc. and, you know, all these other sort of documentaries. But the buying habits at large don't change. I was recently at the largest farmers market in the country. And I'm asking these vendors, you know, since all these movies came out, since all this hype about, you know, being organic has happened, have you noticed a real change? And the guy said that he was a vendor for 20 years. He said, we've seen a lot more attention. Like, people are paying attention, but they're not buying. You know, people go to these farmers markets or these co-ops to kind of vanity shop. To say, well, I bought organic lettuce. But they don't grocery shop. Nobody's dropping, you know, their grocery budget at the farmer's market. They're still going to Walmart super centers. And that's really the problem here. We don't want to change. We just want to yell at somebody so somebody else makes the change for us.
I think it's part of that, and I talk about this along with Food Inc. People should read The Fallacy of the Calorie. And I talk about it in there is, you know, it comes down to a perception of food value. And so much, and even sort of in the basic reptilian, you know, parts of our brain, we tend to associate food value with quantity. And so, yeah, I know the organic's better for me, but I can get 10 of these for the same $1.50. And so, you know, part of what my approach is to say, you know, you don't wake up in the morning and go, God, man, I got to get me 1,200 units of vitamin A today. I'm just craving it. You say, you know, I feel like a salad because that's what your body's telling you. So, you know, part of, I think, the great boon that these local, you know, young chefs have
all
given
right,
us.
All right, wait, Doug, hold on. I'm going to keep you for the entire show. There's only one segment left. I'm going to have to answer the entrepreneurship question tomorrow. We'll be back with Dr. Michael Fenster right after this. All right, we spent the entire show with Dr. Michael Fenster because this issue is so vitally important. You can go to What's Cooking with Doc. You can get his books. Fallacy of the Calorie is a great one. I've read both of them. He's got some more books coming out. Just stay tuned to whatever he's doing. You can follow him on Facebook, Twitter, all that sort of stuff. But, Doc, a couple rapid-fire questions for you in this last segment. Some things that have come in. One, when it comes to... dairy, the suggestion is that we humans don't need or we shouldn't even be consuming dairy. Everything else gets weaned. We don't seem to wean. We eat cheese, we drink milk, we do yogurt. What say you to dairy? Is it bad?
I don't think so, but I do want to draw a distinction between, you know, dairy and fermented dairy products. You know, if we look at ancient cultures, which is actually my next book, what we find is that milk was far too valuable a product for them to really ever drink whole milk. And so it was converted into cheeses and butters, et cetera. And as a matter of fact, cheese, real cheese, not the spray can cheese, but real cheese, again, being a fermented living food, has been shown to have a very positive effect on our gut microbiome, which, gosh, we don't have time to get into. It's a whole other show, but really is like a whole other organ, maybe, you know, sort of the master controlling organ in terms of our health.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And we're seeing a lot of, I guess, fad diets based on, you know, well, we didn't cultivate crops, so we shouldn't eat that. We didn't drink milk, so we didn't eat that. But, I mean, milk and honey, I mean, that's the epitome of paradise for ancient people, a land flowing with milk and honey. It had immense value.
Comment on that is there is no salvation in deprivation, you know, to paraphrase the Buddha. So, you know, I think when it comes to our foods, that's a good approach. You know, don't look for your salvation in excluding natural food types. You know, certainly the processed, the GMO, the altered, adulterated foods that may not be foods at all, we want to stay away from that. But real authentic foods, that's how you become a real authentic human being.
You're telling me the cheese on Cheetos isn't cheese?
You know, Josh, there is no neon orange that glows in the dark like that found in the natural world.
Amen. All right, what about marijuana? This has been getting a lot of attention, a lot of people seeing benefits, and not just from smoking it. There's like the whole oils and injections and all that sort of stuff. Medical marijuana, what say you?
You know, there with, Gupta, I think that for certain people in certain situations, you know, there is a clear benefit. And, you know, again, being a bit of a student of history, I think we have to look at one of the reasons that that was outlawed. And, you know, that actually has nothing to do with the effects, in terms of the happy effects of marijuana. It has to do with economics and paper and, those sorts of politics. And again, that's sort of another show. But in a nutshell, I think for the right folks, it can be very appropriate, very helpful.
Oh, yeah. We could do a whole show on the back end of the medical industry. Who makes up the FDA board? See, that alone is an indicator right there that something's not right here. When you have the very companies that spend $500 million to get a drug approved, and those are the companies that sit on the board to say if Dr. Michael Fentzer's cure for pancreatitis or something can make it to market, well, of course you're going to have a monopoly.
You know, we got to get the fox out of the hen house.
Wow. Okay, so this obesity crisis that we're seeing with children, everybody's getting out of weight. Michelle's program, you know, of eating lunches that basically consist of the cardboard tray they're served on didn't work. People are still getting heavy. What's the cause? Why are we experiencing this massive weight gain?
Well, pick up a copy of The Fallacy of the Calorie, and then you'll be, the smartest food person in the room. And the reason for that is what we're learning is that this really, again, has to do with the gut microbiome and inflammation. Obesity isn't just calories in, calories out, but it's the quality of the food you eat. And since we're limited times, let me just say that there are plenty of examples, human and animal models, showing significant obesity develop in groups that consume fewer calories than lean groups, but the difference is the composition of the gut microbiome, what affects that, these processed foods that we eat. Why has Michelle Obama's program failed? Because she just cuts calories, but she has sold out to these processed manufacturers, so all the food that they are eating is exactly the stuff we were talking about throughout this hour that we need to avoid. It's not real food.
Yeah, and you know, that's the big asterisk, I think, next to what should be food. When you actually go to the grocery store and you look at this massive 40,000 square foot arena of consumption, the food part is actually the small little lining, usually, and the mass middle is not food at all.
Yeah, that's absolutely right, and it can be hard, again, when you're going and you're looking and you're saying, well, gosh, is this organic? Is this GMO? You know, sometimes the organics are like all in one little section. Sometimes they're interspersed throughout the store. So, that's one of the things that, again, I look for is the seasonality. You know, we talked about one reason that folks generally may not be purchasing the quality items, the organics, is that they can be more expensive. But, you know, if you go to your farmer's market and you don't buy the weird stuff, but you buy the stuff that every stand is selling, all the zucchinis, you know what? They're going to be cheap. Then find ways to extend that zucchini. Maybe you pickle it so you have some pickled veggies, you know, months later when zucchinis are out of season, but you've got them fresh, naturally preserved. They taste amazing. They're incredibly delicious, and you're consuming real, authentic food.
Well, let's talk about that, and that might be a good place to end, is the number one objection to eating wonderful, healthy food is, man, it's expensive. And if you go through a grocery store, yeah, you're going to be paying like $20 for an organic chicken or something. But you can find quality food relatively inexpensive, can't you?
Yeah, as I mentioned, you know, when every stand at the farmer's market is selling zucchini, guess what? Free market works. Price of zucchinis are cheaper than when you go to the mega market and purchase it. You've got to find ways to make that last. Other strategies that I teach in the Culinary RX course, again, folks can go to that website. But, you know, when you buy that chicken, organic chicken, you're paying a little more. You buy the whole chicken. Why? Well, in 5 minutes, you can break it down. Then you get a carcass. A carcass is what? Well, instead of throwing it away, it allows you to make chicken stock. All of a sudden, now you're not making chicken stock. You've got healthier, you know, gravies and sauces and soups. You've got the best tasting risotto you've ever made. Why? Because the secret's in the stock. When you chop those organic carrots, you're not just throwing away the tops, you're putting them in that stock. And so you're recycling. And that's really the basic principles of running a professional restaurant that I share with folks, because we don't waste anything because food costs so much and your margins are so small.
Yeah, and you know, if you start looking and you really start making an effort to do this, there's no doubt that the dollar menu at McDonald's is fast, quick, and easy. And admittedly, I have consumed fast food in my my edible history, I guess. But you can find good natural stuff if you put in the effort. The problem is a lot of us don't want to put in the effort.
Well, like anything, I think that's worthwhile in life, it's not going to be given to you. It's got to be earned. And it, absolutely, that is the one requirement. Folks say, well, you know, you're asking me to put effort in. Well, yes, you do. You're going to have to put effort in. But I can show you how to make it fun. I can show you how to make it delicious. And I can show you how to make it really time efficient. And I can show you how to do 99.99% of it, you know, with one good chef's knife. And, you know, so we can do it economically, you know, we can do it deliciously, but we can't do it without effort.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
We've got
all right,
care.
Doc, give us the websites, all the websites that you might have. Just lay it on people.
www.whatscookingwithdoc.com. You can find the article that we talked about this morning there. Go to cardiochef.com. You can read about me. Click on the Culinary RX course. Drop me emails on Facebook or Twitter at WCWD. If you'd like to have a culinary us do a Culinary RX course near you, let us know. We did that for culinary professionals, but we're going to try to open it up for the public as well.
Wonderful. Dr. Michael Fenster, always an honor and a privilege to have you, my friend. I cannot wait to do it again. Be safe in your travels, especially now that you're exposing all these truths that the big corporations don't like. Remember, everybody, look into jury nullification. No victim, no crime. Today, tomorrow, and as always, may your path lead to heaven, and may freedom follow in your footsteps.
Hey, thanks for watching. If you loved what I had to say, then subscribe right here. If you hated what I had to say, subscribe right here. It's fun being mad on social media, isn't it? Either way, I'd love to hear from you. Send me an email right there.